The next item of business is topical questions, and at question number one I call Liam Kerr.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the reported funding gap facing Scotland's colleges.
Minister Graham Day.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government budget for 24-25 provides colleges with the same resources which were available in 23-24. And given the extraordinary financial challenges we're facing after years of austerity, I'd hope that Mr Kerr would recognise that as a demonstration of this Government's commitment to our colleges. The Scottish Government will again invest around £2 billion this year in our colleges and universities, enabling over 500,000 people to access the learning opportunities they need to fulfil their potential and deliver the skills that Scotland needs. And that includes over £750 million of investment in the college sector.
Liam Kerr.
Well, cutting through that spin, yesterday it was reported that over the last 3 years, the total combined budget gap stands at nearly £500 million. Audit Scotland warned that risks to the college sector's financial sustainability have increased in the past year, while the SFC has identified three colleges with significant cash flow issues. So, Minister, how will the government's approach to funding and resourcing Scotland's colleges change going forward in response to the apparently existential threat the current approach has created?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I accept there's a gap. I would disagree with the figure that's been quoted. If the GDP deflators used rather than CPI, as the Treasury would recommend, the number is lower, plus the baseline years used aren't comparable because they vary between academic and financial years. But there is a gap in terms of the premise that's been advanced. However, how could it be otherwise, given the financial challenges this government faces? And if Mr Kerr or anyone else wants more money for colleges, and he's perfectly entitled to suggest that should be the case, it's incumbent on him and everyone else to tell us from where in the education or wider Scottish Government budget they would take these monies from.
Liam Kerr.
Well, of course, we did. And if the Minister doesn't accept the figures, perhaps in his next answer he can tell us what he thinks the deficit will be over the 3 years. But, Presiding Officer, Colleges Scotland correctly describes colleges as critically important to Scotland's people, communities and the economy, and crucial to delivering on the Scottish Government's priorities. However, EIS Fella says that the colleges haven't been given sufficient funding to do the job they are expected to do. And Colleges Scotland say they cannot keep delivering more with less. So, if this government will not make different choices and fund colleges properly, which of the Scottish Government's purported priorities does it no longer require colleges to deliver?
Minister.
So, Presiding Officer, this sounds like Groundhog Day, to be quite honest, because yet again, with the opposition coming to the chamber and asking for more funding. And that's fine, but our budget's been decimated by his party's decisions at Westminster. And of course, the cost of living crisis visited on us, all of us, our colleges included, by the Tories, is relevant to this as well. So if he wants more money for colleges, where is it going to come from? Something we'd have to give, Presiding Officer. What are the Conservatives suggesting we cut? Is it to invest more in colleges? Is it schools? Is it our hospitals? Because that's the stark choice that everyone has to face. But of course, we do know one thing. The Tories, and at least some in the Labour Party, are united in wanting to cut. They want to cut free tuition, and students in Scotland will never forgive them for that.
There is a great deal of interest in putting supplementaries. I'd be grateful if we could keep questions and responses concise, and I call Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As the Minister's touched on, despite the shadow of 14 years of Westminster austerity, Scotland is still choosing to invest in its public sector. So can the Minister provide further information on what action the Scottish Government is taking to ensure the college sector is built on fair work principles, principles that support both staff and students alike?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, the Fair Work First criteria that sets out a range of fair work practices, including the payment of the real living wage, no inappropriate use of 0 hours contract, the offer of flexible and family-friendly work practices, and investment in workforce development. And Fair Work is a term and condition of funding from the Scottish Government and the SFE and SFC, and those conditions of funding places are an obligation on institutions, for exemplars of Fair Work. The Government expects the Scottish Funding Council to continue monitoring adherence across the college sector.
Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In his resignation speech yesterday, the First Minister told us that it is often the most marginalised in society who bear the brunt. Does the Minister accept that that is exactly what is happening and will happen with these cuts to further education and cuts to student places?
Minister.
I accept that the funding settlement sets challenges for colleges. I don't accept the picture that's painted by Richard Leonard. But again, I say to Richard Leonard what I've said to William Kerr. If he believes, and he's perfectly entitled to advance this argument, that we should spend more money on colleges, he has to tell us from where it comes from. And I seem to recall that during the budget pressure, there was not a word out of Labour by way of a proposal to cut up the education budget in a different way.
Willie Rennie.
Back in January, the Scottish Funding Council said that a number of colleges were in a dangerous financial position with extreme cash flow situations. Is that still the case? And can the Minister assure the Parliament that no college will be allowed to close?
Minister.
Mr Rennie asks a fair point. The SFC has flagged concerns about a number of colleges. What I can provide Mr Rennie assurance on is the extensive work that the SFC does on behalf of the government to engage with those colleges to ensure that they can move towards a sustainable footing. These are not easy times for some colleges. There are very significant long-term systemic challenges that they face. But the SFC is extremely active in this space to try and ensure that these colleges are helped into a more secure future.
Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister will be aware of the First Minister's question asked last Thursday around the lack of engineering apprenticeships to serve the engineering cluster that is in Prestwick Airport. With Mangata project failing and bringing £84 million back into the Ayrshire Growth Deal, wouldn't that help the Minister then to fund the places at Ayrshire College that he has been cut?
Minister.
To pick up directly on Mr Whittle's point, because it's a very reasonable point to make, there is considerable demand for engineering apprenticeships. In fact, it's one of the largest sectors that we support. I'm aware of the demand from the Prestwick cluster. He will recognise, of course, there's demand for engineering apprenticeships all over the country. And this is part of what's driving the reform agenda in the space of apprenticeships, to look at where the greatest need of the economy is, where the greatest demand is, and to match apprenticeships to that. So that's an ongoing piece of work. But I'm happy to engage further with Mr Whittle on this subject.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In answering the questions here, the government is behaving like they're not the government. Colleges across Scotland have identified the same problems: chronic funding gaps, fewer students, a drop in student support, and staff striking for fair pay. But one thing that is consistent, it's all happened on this government's watch. They've stepped in to ensure public sector staff secured appropriate cost of living pay uplifts elsewhere, but not in the college. So can I ask the Minister, when will he stop this slopey-shouldered approach that the government seems to hold colleges in such low regards, and finally step in, support students and staff, and sort the mess that he's left colleges in?
Minister.
And once again, Presiding Officer, we see Labour behaving like a party not fit for opposition, never mind government, which it aspires to be in government. They aspire to be in government in Westminster before not too long. I say to Pam Duncan, yet again, I reiterate what I've said to Richard Leonard, to William Kerr. You cannot come to this chamber and rattle off a list of demands, and this is the college sector alone, without in any way identifying how that would be funded. That is reckless.
With apologies to those members I'm unable to take in this question, I must move on to question number two, and I call Carol Mockin.
To ask the Scottish Government for what reason the number of private GP clinics have reportedly tripled since the COVID-19 pandemic.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The pandemic was the biggest shock in the history of the NHS, and its effects are still felt. Activity in general practice has returned to pre-pandemic levels once GPs could safely offer more appointments. But perceptions, I believe from my time as Health Secretary, false perceptions persist that GP practices are unwilling to see patients, and that perception endures. General practice is fundamental to an NHS that's free at the point of need, and we've invested £1.2 billion into general practice last year. We are working to better understand the increasing complexity of GP appointments and the nature of demand so we can reform and support the delivery of better services to patients.
Carol Mockin.
Thank you. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept that by not adequately funding GP services, this government have overseen the development of a two-tier health system where the worst off go without, and even those on lower incomes are forced to pay for them or their loved ones just to see a GP?
Cabinet Secretary.
No, I think we, as I said in my answer to my original question, we're investing £1.2 billion into general practice. I think there is much complexity around what primary care in general practice in particular, is facing around the complexity of those that are presenting at their surgeries. That is meaning that the time that is required by GPs or multidisciplinary teams that we are also investing in to add capacity means that the pressure being felt in primary care, GP practices in particular, is still very high. That's why, as I said, it's so important that we continue to have those discussions with GPs, as I do. I met three GP practices over the last week, and hear from them as to what would make the difference to add that capacity, ensure that people continue to get that service, and divert people, prevent people from entering into the secondary and acute system.
Carol Malkin.
Thank you. The complexity in the system is that for patients trying to see a GP, the number of GP practices in Scotland have fallen by almost 100 over the last decade to 897, a fall represented all over Scotland, and GP numbers dropped from 4,514 in 2022 to 4,474 last year. Cabinet Secretary, this is regressive, not progressive. Can the Cabinet Secretary give the public any assurance at all that this trend will reverse? And what can they expect to see being delivered by this government to increase availability of GPs to our constituents?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Carol Malkin. So we can already see that in Scotland, per 100,000 of population, we have a higher number of GPs than anywhere else in the UK. In Scotland, we have 81 GPs per 100,000, excluding specialist trainees. In England, that's 62, Wales 65, and Northern Ireland 76. Underlines the pressure that there is across the UK in terms of recruitment and retention, which is why I'm so pleased that we have a record 1,200 GPs currently in training. It's why we are doing the work that we are around recruitment and retention, for which I could less than happy to follow up with Carol Malkin in writing on the various measures that we're taking around recruitment and retention, and on activity levels, why I'm so pleased that we continue to see general practice, primary care in general, having such a high level of activity. 90% of all NHS activity happens within the primary care sector. That is critically important to make sure we continue to have a strongly functioning health service, and why the reform discussions that I'm taking forward focus on how we can continue to see that investment going into primary care, and how we can continue the prevention work that they do, avoiding further longer-term ill health, and making sure we take a population health approach to what we are endeavouring.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary just provide an update regarding the ScotGem programme for recruitment and retention, as well as ensuring us that becoming a GP remains an accessible and attractive career choice across Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I'm very happy to underline the work that's been done through ScotGem, and we're looking to ensure that we learn how that investment is working to ensure that we can continue to see GPs arrive into rural communities, and GPs and practices are the foundation of community healthcare. That is true across Scotland, but particularly the case in rural and island communities. So I'm encouraged by our recruitment pipeline, over 1,200 GPs now in Scotland's training system. We recently led a working group on improving retention, working with partners. We'll consider further supports across the career span, and allocating over £1 million a year on GP retention initiatives aimed at ensuring becoming a GP remains an accessible and attractive career choice. It includes Golden Hellos, the GP retainer scheme, the GP coaching programme, early career first five CPD, and our national wellbeing hub, as well as a range of fellowships.
Sandesh Gulhani.
Declaration of interest as a practicing NHS GP. We are not coping. Cabinet Secretary. GPs are struggling and primary care is on its knees. The Cabinet Secretary is right when he says that 90% of all patient contact occurs in primary care, which begs the question, why are we not adequately funding primary care? We are crying out for better funding. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept that the GP contract has failed to be implemented in its entirety? And does the Cabinet Secretary accept that the GP contract has disadvantaged rural GPs?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'd be more than happy to have a conversation, as I have done previously with Sandesh Galhani, as I would do with any other colleagues across this Parliament, around where we need to make improvements, where the reforms that are required to see a sustainable an accessible health service going forward can be achieved. Primary care is, of course, absolutely central to that. I'm more than happy to hear where, within a financially constrained budget, not just for the health and social care portfolio, but across the government, where Sandesh Galhani would shift resource in order to see that investment that I would want to see going into primary care. Of course, as I've said, the primary care practitioners, the GPs that I have met over recent weeks, are talking about the pressures that they are under. That is partly driven by, the complexity of the patients that they're seeing before them, the longer time that they're needing to spend in order to take part in diagnosis and treatment. And that is why we also need to take a population health approach to what we're taking, so that those people that are presenting at primary care at the moment are coming forward in a healthier way.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions.